discussing about the future of higher education and research cooperation. I am confident the deliberations and outcome of the internationalization of higher education and research cooperation will bring out some good outcome in the form of giving orientation and awareness about what is the higher education of Germany and what are all the avenues and opportunities available for the students of all these South Asian countries, especially in India, not only in education but also in research. Equally, I am happy this occasion will be a good platform for higher education institutions of India to tell about what is the opportunity which is being provided as per the National Education Policy of 2020, with a lot of relaxation, flexibility in offering programs, especially for the students coming from other parts of India as well. And as far as the ad is concerned, I am very happy that I traced the some statistics, which is very encouraging. And I would like to share with other participation as well. Right now, there are 88 scholarships which are being provided to the students coming over there, and both for graduate and doctoral program as well. It is a really very interesting to note that the nationally supervised study work is also available in Germany for the students who are coming over there to continue their PhD program. These are all quite interesting as well. And I'm happy the universities which are all going to participate in this program will certainly get more input about the facilities, programs, and scholarship concessions available for the students who are aspiring students to come over to Germany as well. Friends, it is a proven fact that despite of having second largest higher education system in the world, none of its 1,100 universities or 44,000 colleges in the top world ranking. That is very unfortunate as far as the Indian standard and quality of higher education is concerned. But you can agree with this. As all of us aware, India provide one of the largest pools of manpower, yet the quality of manpower is concerned. So it is a time the policymakers and administrators of apex bodies to think about how can we enhance the skill by which we can make our own students very demand oriented, not only locally and internationally as well. When it's the case, see, again, I would like to look after the parameters and criterions which are being followed by various international organizations while they are grading the institutions, while they are giving ranking to the institutions as well. And the most of the parameters are connected with international collaboration and availability of foreign faculty in the campus, exchange of faculty, exchange of student, and depth of research outcome in collaboration with the foreign universities. So now the standard of any institutions of India is being ranked on the basis of its collaboration and joint venture with the other institutions of other countries as well. Now the time has come to think seriously, what is internationalization of education? Why it should be taken into account with the priority? Internationalization includes policies and practices undertaken by academic system and institutions and even individuals also to cope with global environment. Further to add, the motivation for internationalization includes commercial advantage, knowledge, and language acquisition, enhancing the curriculum with the international content, to name a few, opening branch campuses, cross-border collaborative arrangements, and a program for international students. That and all fine. When it's the case, it has been already established that students who have competitive advantage, international education enjoys a higher employment in global markets. Yes, the students all along all the Asian countries, we talk about gross enrollment ratio and we praise ourselves. Our GER is good. At the same time, we are not giving equal importance for conversion ratio. In India, what we call as conversion ratio, when 100 students is attending an interview, only 6 students are getting placement, we take it 6% is the conversion ratio. But as far as, though India and other Asian countries are good in GER, but they are very weak in conversion ratio. The findings, what it said, you know, it is all because lack of skill. At the same time, the study conducted by researchers saying that the students who have international exposure, the students who have went abroad and had his degree or training, the skill what they have gained, it is much, much useful that those students are getting advantage in getting placement, employment in India. So there is no option as far as the Indian higher education is concerned to think about international education. It is a compulsion because the overall objective of higher education of India is offering, providing employable education. That is the overall objective of higher education of India. To attain that objective, definitely all the higher education institutions should work towards enhancing the skill of the students. Not only mere skill, but also internationally acquired skill. Then only the overall objective of higher education institutions can be improved, can be established. When it's a case, now there are certain skills, specific skills. It's the right time I have to mention about those skills, few skills as well. The international skills, which can be listed under two headings. One is key skills developed through international mobility. Another category is key skills required by employers. I would like to list out a few of these skills developed through international mobility. They are of self-awareness, self-confidence, sense of identity, and personal independence. Likewise, being informed, greater interest in global affairs and cross-cultural perspectives. Organization skills, project management, decision-making, creativity, and taking on responsibility. These are all the few skills which is very possible through international mobility. Likewise, the skills which are required by employer, they are of self-awareness, initiative enterprises, willingness to learn, planning and organizing, and integrity. I am confident the internationalization of education, especially our students go abroad of any countries, developed countries, developing countries, they are very much assured of acquiring these level of categories of skills. That is one part, right? What India is doing, whether India is really interested. Yes, India is very much flexible nowadays. India broadened its objectives and policies as well. I have to accept very openly. Until recently, the higher education system of India, even Ministry of Higher Education, even the University Grants Commission, they are very much rigid. For an example, even for giving permission for offering dunning program, even for offering joint degree program, they are not permitted by our own apex bodies of India. After getting the document of national education policy, now the mindset of the policymakers, the mindset of the education administrators and vice chancellor like me totally changed, because avenues and opportunities are given in ample way in the national education policy as well. It has opened gates and it allowed for the cross border in the area of India to be promoted as foreign study destination. Each university is asked by Ministry of Education to open a separate office for international students. Likewise, the foreign colleges can set up colleges in India, the same case with the universities as well. Likewise, Indian universities which are in first 100 ranks are permitted to establish their campuses in abroad also. And the subject like music, arts, literature to be taught in all colleges of India, because these are all the subjects which are being preferred by the foreign students from all parts of the world as well. And moreover, there are certain programs in the form of notification already issued by Government of India, that is academic banking credit. It has been notified to all the universities of India. What it says, the student of any level, undergraduate or postgraduate, they can acquire credit of any subject of his interest. Need not be from the University of India, but also university abroad can be brought to his host university, parent university. That credit can be included such a way the student is getting opportunity of learning things from outside, carrying those skills inside, and making his degree employable and much useful as well. Likewise, there are a lot of changes coming out in, and India also, there's a study abroad program as well, which is getting very popular among the students who are interested to come to India also. And for your kind information, in the national accreditation bodies like National Assessment Accreditation, NAC, and NIRF, they are giving good weightage to the institutions of universities and colleges who are really good enough in promoting international education in the form of exchange of faculty, in the form of joint conferences, in the form of joint research, in the form of joint publication. They give much weightage. On that basis, they give grading and ranking as well. So now, really, India is very much for promoting, developing, even motivating education institutions to go for international education. To conclude, I should appreciate the organizers of this program, especially DAG, for organizing a connecting Germany and South Asia program, which will be much useful. I am very confident which will be eye-opener to the education institutions of South Asia, who are all interested to strengthen their quality at the same time to make their program very successful. Thank you very much for the opportunity given to me. Wish the program every successful. Thank you very much indeed. Namaste.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tiwazagam, for highlighting the dynamic which is in the system at the moment, and the gateways which are open at the moment in higher education and internationalization in India. The DAG is more than 60 years present with an office in New Delhi, who is coordinating its activities in South Asia. But as one is never ever too old to try new things, we thought together with the EIU that we approach this conference a bit different. So for the first time, we have been run a joint call for contribution for the conference, and the response was overwhelming. We selected the speakers of the four sessions later this afternoon from more than 100 applications. This shows the interest and the relevance of the topic of internationalization, not just on the policy level, but also on the ground. I'm now glad to welcome Mr. Müller, Deputy Secretary General of the DAG, and would like now to invite him to the virtual stage. Mr. Müller, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, esteemed President of the Association of the Indian Universities, Dr. Tiruvasagam. Thank you very much for your introductory words and remarks on the situation in which you see the Indian universities in the sense of internationalization. Esteemed Secretary General of the AIU, Dr. Mittal, dear Philipp von Ritter, Science Attaché at the German Embassy in New Delhi, dear participants of the conference, good morning for me, good afternoon for you. On behalf of DAG, the DAG, as you wish to call the German Academic Exchange Service, I'm very glad to be here, however, virtually, on the occasion of the opening of the digital conference Connecting Germany and South Asia, the Future of Higher Education and Research Cooperation. Organized jointly by the DAG Regional Office in New Delhi and the Association of Indian Universities. These last years have shown us the enormous importance of science and innovation, and that global challenges cannot be addressed on a national level. This means international cooperation in research and higher education is essential to address the problems that humankind faces today. The Asia-Pacific region is important to Germany. This has been highlighted through a national strategy published by the German government in 2020, but also through the establishment of the DAG, the DAG Regional Office in New Delhi, as Mrs. Lush already said, the first office outside Europe 61 years ago. The international exchange between Germany and the region of South Asia has been growing since then. Germany hosted in 2020 more than 34,000 students from the region, the fastest growing community of international students, I can say. In 2020 alone, the DoD supported more than 3,300 scholars and students who went to Germany or came from Germany into your region. Currently, more than 520 cooperation projects exist between German higher education institutions and institutions in the region. More than 30 funding schemes by Indian and German funding bodies are providing financial means for Indo-German cooperation projects in higher education and research. 14 German higher education and research institutions are present with an office in India and are working together under the umbrella of the German Center for Research and Innovation, DWIH, or DWIH, as we call it. The high number of registrations for this conference, Mrs. Lush already has mentioned this, shows that there's a huge interest to develop the existing cooperation further and to expand the networks. The topic of internationalization and international cooperation is clearly on the agenda of the institutions from the participating countries, being Germany, India, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Nepal, and Bhutan. As the world's largest funding organization for the exchange of students and researchers, internationalization is our daily business. We are known for our individual scholarship programs. Another important field of our activity is to promote and support university cooperation projects between institutions in Germany and the world. We have been supporting more than 90 cooperation projects between 2017 and 2020 with countries in South Asia. This shows the importance of the region to us as well. Furthermore, the DoD New Delhi has been continuously engaging in policy dialogues with stakeholders, but also in supporting the internationalization of higher education institutions in the region. In September this year, DoD hosted a workshop on double degree programs to discuss the opportunities and barriers in setting up double degree programs between universities of both countries. Cooperation between higher education institutions is the fundament on which sustainable academic exchange is built. Our today conference is organized and conceptualized from this perspective. We ran a call for presentations, as Mrs. Lush said, for focused sessions, and invited higher education institutions from the region to participate. From more than 70 entries, we selected the speakers of today's sessions. The next 5 days will give you the opportunity to gain insights in different ongoing cooperation projects, to discuss different aspects of internationalization, but also to expand your network through B2B meetings. My thanks go to our partner institution, the Association of Indian Universities, AIU, who joined hands to organize this conference. I also want to thank the keynote speakers, the panelists as well, as the speakers of the focused sessions. And obviously, I wish to thank my colleagues at the DoD Delhi office, Mrs. Katalash and her team. I wish all of us inspiring days and fruitful discussions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Müller, for these inspiring and engaging words. We've already heard that the conference takes place in time when the topic of international cooperation in higher education gains momentum in the region of South Asia. We have tackled already the new education policy, but also the new science and technology policy draft of India is addressing the need for strategic international cooperation. The project InterNEPINT, which is financed by the European Union, supports the internationalization of the process of higher education institutions in Nepal and India. The AIU has been a long-standing promoter and enabler of internationalization of higher education in India. So I'm very glad that they decided to join hands with us. And I would now like to invite Dr. Mittal, Secretary General, to the virtual stage and to address the audience. Dr. Mittal, you are muted. You have to unmute yourself.
Thank you, Katja. Thank you very much. The Honorable President of AIU, Professor Thiru Vasagam, the esteemed Deputy Secretary General of DAD, Christian Müller, Katja, and from Embassy Philip, and all the participants, the key speakers, the panelists, a very good afternoon to you from India. First of all, I would like to thank DAD for partnering with AIU in holding this prestigious conference. And I'm aware how many iterations went through in sort of deciding the structure of the conference, in deciding the sessions which should be there, in deciding the speakers, panelists, as well as the keynote speakers. Just immediately after the inaugural, there'll be our first keynote speaker, Professor Rajkumar, who is the Vice Chancellor of Jinbei Global University. So thanks for partnering with us. And you all know that India is now wanting to do internationalization in a big way. The National Education Policy of India, which is a very, very innovative policy. In that, I think for the first time, a lot of emphasis has been given to internationalization of higher education. And the policy for the first time says that, okay, around top 100 universities of the world can come and establish their campuses in India. The bill to that effect was pending in the parliament for a long, long time. But for the first time, the policy intent is there that, yes, we want foreign universities in India. We want our universities to go abroad. The joint degrees, dual degrees, which were pending for a long, long time, and all the foreign universities as well as Indian universities, they were wanting that we should be able to offer joint degrees. That is now becoming a reality, and the policy has clearly stated that the transfer of credits between in the Indian and the foreign universities can be there. And then the policy has even given a very thinking to a very, very minute issue, like having international offices in Indian universities, because there are some Indian universities who are having the international students, but not an international office, which is creating a problem for the international students. And on the part of AIU, we are taking two big initiatives to promote internationalization. One is establishing an AIU collaboration portal, in which the universities in India who are very good in a specific area, or maybe they have very good facilities, discipline, faculty, research, patrons in a particular area, they will be visible on the AIU portal so that it becomes easy for the foreign universities to collaborate with Indian universities, because right now they are able to see the overall ranking of the university or the accreditation grade through the National Assessment and Accreditation Council. But for each subject which university is good, that is not visible. So AIU has started that. And second thing, which I think will be of interest to you, is that we are establishing a Indian network of international higher educators, because so far India doesn't have a network of international higher educators. So in this network, there will be a lot of information sharing, resource sharing, so that everybody can flourish and everybody can, I mean, so that the internationalization can be promoted. By way of numbers, we have just heard from Christian that how many research projects are there, facilities are there. But when we talk of Indian students in Germany and the German students in India, we see that only around 38 students last year, only 38 German students came to study in India, mostly for the undergraduate program and 1 and 2 for the PhD program. And but when we see the number of students which are going to Germany, it's more than 20,000 which go every year. But by way of the number of countries, I mean, if we rank the number of countries to which the Indian students are going, Germany stands at number 10 with more than 20,000 students. The other options are, I mean, the people are going to mostly to USA. USA is number one. So I think we have to explore more ways of student exchange between Germany and India. And more, I mean, DAD is offering, of course, excellent scholarships, which are sought after. I mean, students are wanting those scholarships. But I think it, I mean, because right now Germany is at number 10 in terms of number of international students, I mean, number of students who go out from India to study abroad. So if we want to raise that number or status, we need to, I think, have more collaborative efforts and more student exchange programs, more faculty exchange programs, and more collaboration between the Indian and the foreign universities. I wish the conference success, and I'm sure it will go a big way in promoting and strengthening the relationships between India and Germany. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mittal, for your words, and also for the points which we have to tackle and which we have to take up in the conference, but also in the future, to have a truly partnership and mobility in both directions. International cooperation, higher education lives through partnerships and networks, and it's the universities who are building these partnerships and networks. But it's also with the support of the national bodies and the governments that cooperation is possible. They set the policy framework and are offering public funding for cooperation projects. And the importance of science and education cooperation has been highlighted as well as by the Indian as the German government through strategy papers, joint declarations, but also joint funding. I want to mention here the Indo-German partnership program, which is currently funded together by the Indian and German government. We are funding 9 cooperation projects with a value of more than 7 million euro. I'm therefore very, very glad that the German embassy joins us today in person of Philipp von Ritter, head of the science section. So Philipp, the floor is yours to give your perspective on cooperation from the perspective of science diplomacy. Philipp, you have to unmute yourself, you're on mute.
Thank you, Katja. I will be brief because much and many encouraging things have already been said. But as you say, I think I'm really delighted to be here. We are very happy that the German Ministry of Research could assist with funding to this event. And I have to say that I'm also, I can speak for the whole embassy and for the Foreign Office in Berlin also, that we are following this event with great interest, because this kind of event corresponds to a new and as several kinds of priorities that we are having in our German foreign policy. Of course, the Indo-Pacific region with India as a strategic partner, but also more engagement in science diplomacy in the field of knowledge, research, of higher education, where we see a key element of our bilateral relations with our key partners, among them, of course, India. And that's why I'm really delighted that there's 500 participants to this event. I am sure that in the coming 5 days, you will have very, very intense discussions. And these 5 days may even seem in the end a bit short for you, because this is a very important task that you have ahead. And it's very important because internationalization is at the heart of our priorities. And internationalization is not obvious. It takes some efforts. Internationalization doesn't have one size fits all solutions. When we internationalized our German system, we could not just implement the way the Americans had done it before for their system or the Brits. Every system has to find their own solution. And that's why it's so important that Dr. Tito Vazagam and Dr. Mittal, that you are joining and that you co-host this platform. And that's why it's also so important that the universities are here, because internationalization, as Katja said, can only in the end be done by universities. And it will be done with many, many small steps. And this is a great platform to start discussions on where these small steps have to start. And all I can tell you from the embassy side is that we are ready to assist. Wherever you need our assistance for your internationalization efforts, we stand ready as the German embassy in New Delhi, as our consulates general, but also as the other embassies in the region. And with this, I wish you a very successful meetings in the coming 5 days. Thank you. And over back to you, Katja.
Thank you so much, Philipp, for your warm words and also for the support the embassy and the consulate generals are constantly giving the universities in India and Germany and also your colleagues in the other countries to higher education cooperation. So one could ask why the organizers decided to run a 5-day digital conference in time where everybody is maybe a bit tired of online meetings, online teachings and so on. But this conference offers you the unique opportunity to interact and connect with each other, and that's why it's 5 days long. Let me highlight that after today's sessions and tomorrow's panelist discussion and keynotes, that we provide a platform for B2B meetings. You have the possibility to touch base with all the participants, either you message them or you could request for meetings. And the meetings then will be facilitated on the platform between Wednesday and Friday. And I just had a look in the tool and I already saw that we already have more than 140 meetings agreed and more than 180 pendings. So log into the platform and have a look in the participants list build up based on your research interest, the people you would like to interact with at. We have 37 German universities on board, but also representatives of funding agencies like Eurexis and the German Research Foundation. So maybe you take a couple of minutes today in the break and connect with people you would like to speak, or you check the profiles to see if somebody already requested for a meeting. I would like, this is a unique opportunity to connect, not just between India and Germany, also across the regions. Bangladesh, Nepal, Bhutan, Sri Lanka are also present on the platform. I would like to thank Dr. Tiruvasagam, Mr. Müller, Dr. Mittel, and Mr. Ritter for addressing the audience today. We have an interesting and engaging program ahead of us. Join the keynote, which we will just start here in this room in a minute. And we also have 4 sessions today. Tomorrow, we will discuss with representatives of Nepal, Bhutan, Sri Lanka, and Bangladesh on international cooperation. And we have a look into 60 years of mobility and mobility patterns and discuss with the panel their vision of internationalization in 2030. And not to forget the possibility to talk to the participants. So before we head to the keynote and the session, let me thank the conference organizing team in DART and AIDU for their work they put into the conference. I hereby close the opening session. I'd like to draw the attendees that we will continue here in this room in a minute or two with the first keynote provided by Dr. Raj Kumar, who will talk on the international education in India and democratization. So thanks again for joining, and see you in a minute for the keynote session.
Thank you. Thank you, Kaj.
Hello, Professor Kumar. I hope you're well and we find you well.
Very good afternoon to you. Great to see you.
Yes, as usual in the conference, we're running a bit late, but nevertheless, we're going to have a couple of minutes to extend afterwards as we have the coffee break after your keynote speech. So let me say a warm welcome to you, but also a warm welcome to everybody to the first keynote of the conference Connecting Germany and South Asia. We are very glad that the keynote is spoken by you today, organized by you. One year ago, the Indian government launched the National Education Policy 2020, which, with the words of you, Professor Kumar, augurs a new era in Indian higher education. It's an outstanding vision statement and inspiring policy document that seeks a fundamental transformation in the landscape of higher education. Closed quotation. We have witnessed that also the discussion about the internationalization of Indian universities has gained momentum with the launch of the NDP. There's a couple of articles which have disappeared. You contributed, Professor Mittal, who is here, contributed. One can witness that there is an ongoing and that the discussion on internationalization is gaining momentum. Today's keynote will focus on the democratization of international education in India. So let me introduce our distinct keynote speaker, Professor Dr. C. Raj Kumar, the founding Vice Chancellor of OP Jindal Global University, India. He's an accomplished legal scholar and works in various fields. I was surprised to see which fields you all cover: human rights development, comparative constitutional law, corruption and governance, disaster management, but also higher education. We have a huge number of publications, 7 books and over 150 publications in peer-reviewed journals in Australia, Hong Kong, India, Japan, Singapore, UK, and the USA. So we have a really international person here with us today. Professor Kumar is a Rhodes Scholar and has academic qualifications from the University of Oxford, Harvard, the University of Hong Kong, the University of Delhi, and the Loyola College. He was appointed as the VC at the age of 34 in 2009, when the university established at the Jindal Global University. And this is one of the 20 universities in India which has been declared as an institution of eminence by the government of India, and the only one who is not focused on the STEM field. So, Professor Kumar, thank you for joining us today and sharing your perspectives on international education in India. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Katya Lash. And let me first of all congratulate DAAD for really putting together this fantastic conference on the future of higher education and research cooperation in South Asia. I want to pay my tribute to the Association of Indian Universities. It's the president, Dr. Thiruvasagam, the secretary general, Dr. Pankaj Mittal, and all other office bearers of both the organizations, including our friends from South Asia. I'm very delighted that this conference is not only on India, but on South Asia. So I appreciate the effort of DAAD to connect through this conference, the larger South Asian imagination towards internationalization. I want to first of all begin by saying that I have been deeply inspired by the evolution of German higher education. For some of you who may or may not be aware, that the modern research university that all of us are talking about and want India to have them is a part of the Humboldtian model of research university. In fact, the Humboldt University was the very founding vision of how modern research university ought to be created and evolved. And that vision that was led by Germany pretty much traveled around the world, including the United States and other parts of the world. So all of us today owe a debt of intellectual gratitude to the German thinkers, as well as scholars and society in general, for providing that leadership, the historical leadership that pretty much transformed the landscape of higher education. And today we have a situation where the 200 plus countries in the world are all aspiring to create research universities, at least a good number of them, for shaping the future of knowledge societies in their own respective context. I also want to mention that I've been a very privileged person to be connected to Germany. I have had the opportunity to study German in the Max Müller Bauern, both in Chennai and in Delhi. And I had the opportunity to connect with German institutions very early on. My father had several Max Planck fellowships across Freiburg and Heidelberg and many other parts of Germany. So for me, the connect with Germany goes very, dates very early in my own life and career. So I also want to bring to the attention that the vision of internationalization that I intend to speak about, particularly focusing on the democratization of international education, I am calling it as India, but it holds good to South Asia as well, is that I would like to start by making an important, two important references. One is a very famous lecture delivered by none other than Max Müller at the University of Cambridge in 1882. And Professor Max Müller was a professor at Oxford. He was invited to the University of Cambridge to deliver this lecture to this batch of cohort of people who have joined the Indian Civil Service. And they were planning to move to India, and actually they wanted to have this introduction to India. So this absolutely amazing set of lectures delivered by Max Müller, simply pretty much laid the foundations, and the lecture title was India, What Can It Teach Us? And I want to make one reference to that. And Max Müller says in this lecture, and I quote, "If I were to look over the whole world to find out the country most richly endowed with all the wealth, power, and beauty that nature can bestow, in some parts a very paradise on earth, I should point to India. If I were asked under what sky the human mind has most full developed some of its choicest gifts, has most deeply pondered on the greatest problems of life, and has found solutions of some of them which well deserve the attention even of those who have studied Plato and Kant, I should point to India. And if I were to ask myself from what literature may draw that character which is most wanted in order to make our inner life more perfect, more comprehensive, more universal, in fact, more truly human, a life not for this life only, but a transfigured and eternal life, again, I should point to India," unquote. This was one of the most renowned German scholars, a professor at Oxford, Max Müller, speaking in this lecture in 1882. Of course, we know that the German Goethe Institutes in India have been called and have paid a lot of tribute to it. And I had the privilege to study in one of those institutions. The second important reference I want to make is that it is not that the vision of internationalization in South Asia is something that we have just discovered, either through the national education policy or for that matter, the creation of a number of universities, including our own in recent times. In fact, the history and civilization heritage that India had contributed, or that the Indian subcontinent had contributed many years ago, reflected that vision long before the world discovered the idea of internationalization. I had the privilege to study in Oxford University, which is nearly 800 years old. Bologna in Italy is nearly 900 years old. But India had institutions of higher learning, including Nalanda and Takshashila and Vallabhi and Vikramshila, long before any of these institutions. In fact, the Nalanda University, was one of those institutions which was continuously run for 800 years from the 5th to the 12th century. It was a completely residential university, expected to have more than 2,000 faculty members and 10,000 students. And the remarkable thing about Nalanda was that the faculty members attracted scholars, from places as distant as China, Korea, Japan, Tibet, Mongolia, Turkey, Sri Lanka, and Southeast Asia. And there were students from other parts of the world, and the most detailed accounts, which many of us know, were from Chinese scholars. And the best known of this is Yuan Zhang, who carried back many hundred scriptures, which were later translated to Chinese as well. And I can go on and on about those things. So in some ways, if we are promoting internationalization in South Asia today, it is part of a long lost heritage that we are reinventing and reimagining. I'm not going to speak about the national education policy because I believe Dr. Mittal is going to chair a session later. But what I thought I would do is that I want to give some of the big issues in the larger context of internationalization. I want to also take a moment to thank Mr. Christian Müller, Deputy Secretary General DAD, and others who have thought it appropriate to host this conference itself. Now, we all know that globalization as a phenomenon had had a profound impact on every aspect of life, including higher education in India too. Now, as the world becomes more deeply interconnected, Indian universities and universities in South Asia have increasingly embraced the value of international dimensions across their physical campuses. They have been able to secure and manage international partnerships and explore new opportunities for their faculty and students around the world. Now, on the other hand, as we do this, more and more students from South Asia have aspirations to go abroad, and students from other parts of the world are wanting to come to India and other countries in South Asia for their own higher studies, although the number is very, very much smaller than what it is the case with China or many other parts of the developed world. Now, in this context, there has been a sea change towards outlook relating to higher education. Over the past two decades or so, more and more Indian higher education institutions have started to benchmark their teaching and research to global standards, including our own institution, OP Jindal Global University. Dr. Thiruvasagam, the president of AIU, lamented about the fact that very few Indian universities are able to benchmark themselves internationally, and he's absolutely right. And that has become part of a policy concern at the highest levels of government. So the question then we have is that this three-way processes that I just outlined, the idea of globalization, aspirations for Indian students to go abroad, and international students wanting to come to India, this has created a unique opportunity which can ultimately help in the promotion of democratization of international education. The bedrock assumption of international higher education is mobility and travel. Of course, we all know that the COVID-19 pandemic has impacted that, and that could drive intensified efforts towards democratization of international education in India, because more and more people possibly may choose India and other countries in South Asia as their preferred location for higher studies than going abroad. I'm talking about the students in the home countries themselves. So the question then we need to ask is, why is internationalization even important? Well, there is a growing appreciation within the higher education sector of the very many positive benefits of internationalization in terms of the opportunities for faculty and staff to travel and learn, the advancements of research through collaborations, and the multicultural communities it creates. In addition to these things that have been mentioned in literature, I want to also add that we are increasingly living in a globally interdependent world. We are also addressing issues that are of global significance and possibly global impact. While the pandemic has made us learn that, we have other things that are waiting to happen, including the challenge of climate change, for example, the big issues that we're facing, including issues surrounding migration or terrorism or environmental depletion. Those are aspects where it is important for us to recognize the interdependence on the basis of which we function. So the resulting democratization of global education has maximized opportunities for faculty, students, and researchers, to participate in global teaching, learning, and research with or without having to travel internationally. And I'll come back to this in a moment, but I want to say that people are working together and new forms of partnerships are being emerged, particularly at the level of research in which faculty members are engaged in collaborative work. The second is to add a critical component of fostering internationalization that focuses on accessibility and expanding the scope of what is possible in global learning. Now, it's important to mention that universities which are increasingly positioning themselves as global universities have indeed made a mark in global rankings, including in various disciplines, and have ended up investing both intellectual and financial resources in the form of hiring outstanding faculty with publication track record, bringing faculty from different parts of the world, creating a research ecosystem, providing a world-class infrastructure facilities, and also creating international partnerships and building an ecosystem for career services. These things require substantial financial investment, and we need to ask the question how it's going to come for those institutions which may not be able to afford. Now, the unique aspect of what I just said is that this is going to create a situation where there will be inevitably privileged institutions which will be at the forefront of mission to advance international education. So from our standpoint, from a public policy standpoint, we need to ask a question: how do we democratize international education in India so much so that the opportunities to seek that education is not only confined to privileged institutions and privileged people, but how do you take it to the next level and make it more inclusive, and in that process, make it more democratic? All right, let me quickly outline the different forms of internationalizations that we are talking about so that we all are on the same page. Well, we are looking at, there has been there was a time when we talked about internationalization, it was limiting to people doing things in the form of an exchange program. And of course, that's there. So the student exchange program remains a very popular model in which students from one institution, one country, spend periods of time in another country, another institution. And we also have study abroad programs. But then today, internationalization has gone to another level, which is a dual degree program, joint executive education programs, joint publications, joint teaching, joint conferences, joint research collaborations, and joint applications for research grants, including availability for financial assistance for inbound and outbound students, career mobility, including opportunities for pursuing internships, capstone projects in other countries in the world. Geographical spread of international faculty and students. For example, a relatively small university like us, we have over 100 faculty members full-time recruited from 42 countries in the world who are living in Sonipat, Haryana, India, and they are engaged in the effort to internationalize our university. We also are looking at international students who are seamlessly ready to study in multiple jurisdictions. And of course, we don't have Erasmus Mundus type of a program in South Asia. And there is a very strong need for creating something like that. Why South Asia? We don't even have that across Asia. And we need to draw upon the experience of European institutions, including Germany, how In fact, several of my colleagues have been Erasmus Mundus fellows, and they've had the opportunity to study in two or three countries and have obtained qualifications and degrees across these countries, and how their experience of studying in multiple jurisdictions have helped them reimagine the future of international education. So now, why do we need to democratize international education, and how do we achieve it? Well, the most important part of it is that a democratization of global education helps create more inclusive societies. It should not be the privilege of the few, and this is helped a lot by promoting scholarships and fellowships. I mean, I come from a middle-class family in India. My father is a professor, mother is a doctor. For me to be able to come from Chennai to Delhi was such a big deal, to be able to afford education here. But for the Rhodes Scholarship, or for that matter, the several other scholarships I got to go to Harvard, I simply could not have left India. And when I look at young students today, there is the same challenge prevails. Very few students are able to have the opportunity to pursue international education. A relatively affluent university like ours, even when I look at my own students, there are a number of students who simply cannot afford to go abroad because of all these reasons I just mentioned. It's another matter that we provide a world-class education here and they get the benefit of it. But the question, and a hard question that we need to ask, is how do we promote that? Now, we also need to recognize that there is an inherent value attached to the notion of understanding the world better. And that means to be able to promote international education. Young people, I believe, are going to shape the future of India and the world. As we see, I mean, even a country like India has 850 million people who are less than 35 years of age. South Asia has the largest number of young people in any region, anywhere in the world. And the life expectancy of young South Asians have increased significantly since the 1940s and 50s, when most parts of the Western world and Eastern world, including China and Japan, will become older. India and South Asia will be younger. And that means these young South Asians will be shaping not only the future of their countries in South Asia, but will be shaping the future of the world. It also means that we, as people who are involved in higher education, need to be imaginative, need to be creative, need to be able to create solutions and opportunities that will empower these people to be able to experience international education in some form or the other. We need to methodologically acknowledge that teaching, pedagogy, research, including research centers, the learning experience of students, and the overall educational opportunities offered to students should be not just national but also international in their different dimension. Comparative research needs to be integrated into every aspect of our higher education. In this regard, let me pay a tribute to another extraordinary German jurist by name Dieter Conrad. In fact, as a law professor and lawyer, all of us pay a lot of tribute to Dieter Conrad, because Dieter Conrad's most important and influential work persuaded and even inspired the Supreme Court of India to create one of the most foundational doctrine of basic features in the Indian Constitution, which pretty much stands even the test of time even today. And of course, Dieter Conrad had visited India many times and had collaborated with many Indian jurists. And so that kind of comparative law and comparative research across different systems, different countries and societies is absolutely critical, not just in law, but every other field. Now, I also want to mention that for India and for countries in South Asia, it's not only about understanding the world, but it's also learning from the best practices from different parts of the world and bringing that context into the Indian society and to the society in South Asia. Global education, I believe, will definitely help countries in South Asia which are aspiring to create institutions of higher learning which can substantially transform these societies. One of the big challenges the countries in South Asia face in growth and development at this stage is that it has to respond to the challenge of higher education viewed from the prism of the demographic advantage that these countries enjoy. As I mentioned earlier, all of us have young populace who are aspiring to receive world-class education. So the question then is, if we could enhance and respond to this demographic dividend by empowering our young people to get the best quality of higher education, to help them pursue not just fruitful careers, but also to look at social transformation, we should be able to create responsible global citizenship. To be able to have responsible global citizenship, we need to promote international education, and it cannot be a policy priority for only a few countries, but it ought to be a policy priority for every country in the world. Now, for that, we essentially have to expose our students not only to a range of disciplines which equip them with the knowledge, expertise, and skills and experience, but also help them locate their knowledge in an international context. All these challenges, I believe, require serious thought and reflection, as well as knowledge to empower societies, which is the kind of global educational opportunities that institutions such as us and many other institutions in South Asia attempt to offer. It's also important for us to recognize that we in South Asia need to radically transform the existing institutional structures in which higher education environment is regulated. I want to recognize that the national education policy and the efforts of progressive organizations such as the Association of Indian Universities is in the right direction. We have a policy framework, and a lot of efforts are being underway as we speak to implement the policy, but also move towards the vision of internationalization. Now, one of the challenges that we continue to face today in countries in South Asia, but definitely in India, is the fact that how do we improve the quality of teaching and research which will respond to the global aspirations of our students? Increasingly, the emphasis around the world is to create a knowledge-based society, and not just in the economic context, but also respond to the bigger challenges of our time. I identified some of these challenges early on. This is where we need to build strengths and synergies, be it the faculty, be it the students, be it the curriculum, the courses, and more importantly, what kind of international exposure that we could offer to our students, which will make it more accessible and more meaningful. I do believe that the national education policy is a new beginning. It outlines a forward-looking policy that has the potential to transform the Indian higher education. But as recommended in the NEP 2020 proposals and suggestions for the implementation, ushering higher education policy reforms for building Atmanirbhar Indian Universities document prepared by OP Jindal Global University and the Association of Indian Universities, there should be creative ways of making world-class education accessible in India. One recommendation I would like to quote from the document related to the provision to enable institutions of eminence to open micro campuses located in the urban suburban areas. All such micro campuses need to have a very strong impetus towards promoting internationalization. Such measures, I believe, will give impetus to the democratization of international education in India. I also strongly believe that we need to recognize the role of private philanthropy in promoting opportunities for international education. In fact, as a beneficiary of that type of philanthropy that gave me opportunity to study at Oxford, I must say that we need to recognize the role and importance of private philanthropy in promoting international education. There are numerous reforms that could be possible, including tax incentives and other forms of incentives that could enable both Indian and international organizations and individuals to recognize the role and the importance of private philanthropy towards contributing to international education. In conclusion, let me say that increasingly, the recognition that global education is relevant has become a dominant thinking among students and parents who, on their part, are prepared to fulfill the higher education aspirations for their own children. This means that institutions need to be empowered to pursue the goal of providing global education. Therefore, I will say that in countries in South Asia, we need more, not less, international collaborations and partnerships that directly influence student learning, research impact, exchange of knowledge and ideas, and interesting enough, that is one of the important goal of NEP 2022 as well. So I would like to end by saying that conferences of this kind that we are seeing today have a very significant role in developing a conversation that will promote the idea of internationalization. In fact, universities are institutions which are futuristic in nature by their very existence. They are not only supposed to create knowledge, but they are also expected to provide a beacon for future, a hope for the future, where new ideas that have yet to take deep roots in society, but those ideas need to be generated in universities, and universities ought to be leading it. Internationalization and democratization of international education is one such idea. The time has come, and it is through the collective contribution of all academic institutions, as well as progressive organizations such as DAAD and AIU, we can move closer towards fulfillment of both equity, equality, and of course, inclusion in higher education. Thank you very much for this opportunity. It's a pleasure to have this, have delivered the speech to all of you.
Thank you so much, Professor Kumar, for your thoughts and for tackling the problem of internationalization in a larger perspective, putting it into the perspectives of globalization, equity, quality, but also comprehensive, attaching the problems of comprehensive internationalization. No, in internationalization, one thinks about mobility, but there's a lot of more things to it, and for advocating of opening the internationalization procedures in countries. I think you tackled the problem of equity and access to international education. And what a question I would like to ask you, and I think that's also a question which I get here from the audience in the chat, is, so isn't the schemes which we are seeing at the moment in a worldwide level, we have, you tackled the institutions of eminence, we had the excellence initiative in Germany, we had funding schemes in Russia, we had funding schemes in China, promoting the excellence of universities and giving those institutions who were successful more funding for internationalization. Isn't that the wrong approach if we advocate for internationalization and to broaden and the access also for smaller institutions?
Well, thank you, Kajal. That's a very important question. Let me say this, that, in India, we have 1,000 plus universities, nearly 40,000 plus colleges. The complexity of regulatory structure requires an extremely intelligent lawyer and judges to figure out the levels of regulation that governs public universities, private universities, state public universities, state private universities, deemed universities, central universities, and standalone colleges, and autonomous colleges, and private colleges, and partly funded colleges, self-financed colleges. So the complexity of Indian higher education is so much so that we need to recognize that somewhere a beginning has to be made. If for the beginning to be made, you need to use some yardsticks, some measures, which will create propensity for success. In fact, the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Sri Narendra Modi, had a very far-sighted vision when he personally pushed the agenda for promoting the idea of institution of eminence. And there was criticism surrounding it, and in a vibrant democracy like India, I don't expect anything less. But the point is that identification of different institutional structures and providing them with help and support, which with demonstrable standards to be achieved within a period of time, is the best way to do it. In fact, before the IOE process, there was another good public policy initiative, the concept of graded autonomy. Nearly 100 universities or so have been given the status of a grade autonomy based on another particular standard. So I think it's important for us to recognize that excellence requires impetus of different kinds, and sometimes you need to take those hard decisions to create models and structures which can be emulated, and this should not be just stopping at that 20 number. In fact, the government has announced that 20 is just a beginning, and the vision is to make it to 50 and 100 on the basis of how this process goes.
Thank you so much. I see Dr. Mittal is still with us. Maybe Dr. Mittal, you would also like to comment, and then I think we could slowly close this keynote session. But Dr. Mittal, the floor is yours.
I would just like to thank Raj for the excellent lecture he gave, because democratization of internationalization is very, very important, especially for a large country like India, in which a lot of diversity is there. So thanks, Raj, for agreeing to come, and thanks for delivering such an excellent address. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mittal. It's such a pleasure.
Yeah, thank you so much for your deliberations, for your thoughts. I think a discussion we should continue, definitely. So thanks so much for joining today.
So on a personal note, Ms. Lash, I will say this, that I have always, lamenting for years that German academic, presence and imagination in India could be a lot more. More and more Indian students should aspire to study in Germany. And I don't see why it should not be the case. But we need to see a lot more of you and all of you in Indian campuses. We need to do much better. We'll have a more separate conversation how, let's say, United Kingdom and Australia and United States and others have done a far better job to attract Indian students than Germany, and what we should do to promote it.
Definitely. Let's take that up in another discussion, also to bring more German students to India, of course, so that we have a real cooperation. I see also Philipp von Ritter here, who is then able for finding the financial means for that. So thank you so much for this wonderful speech, for this opening of the conference. We will continue our program at 2:30 with a session on the internationalization in times of pandemic, something Mr. Professor Kummer all addressed, and the challenges and opportunities which arose from the last 18 months. So thank you so much, and see you here and there, and have a nice day.
Thank you. Thank you very much.